stick up in the middle one. These are the two charges. Stop talking. These two charges are right now at a distance of 10 R from each other, center to center distance. Okay? Fine. Both of the spheres are at rest right now. And then you released. What will happen? They come to each other. There is attraction, negative and positive charge. Fine. Now, when they are about to collide, what's their velocities? Suppose this is mass m, this is 4m. Done? Finding this question difficult or
no?
When they are about to collide, that is the second point and this is your first point.
Yeah.
Just write down the energy equation. Find out U1, U2, K1, K2. W is anyway 0.
Yeah.
And K1 is also 0. Just three things you have to find out. U2, K2 and U1. Only two charges are there, so only one potential will be involved.
So what will you do when they are just touching?
When they are just touching. Center to center distance will be then?
Yeah.
Will be R plus 2R, 3R.
Yeah.
So many hints are there. fine. These kind of questions, don't expect them in school, but don't get surprised also, because last year board exam was like that. In fact, previous question was from NCERT only. Okay, shall we proceed? Fine, so now, if I have a point charge like this, right now, a point charge Q1 over here, and another point charge Q2 at a distance R. Fine. They will have a potential energy. They will have a potential energy, which is K Q1 Q2 by R. Simple. Okay. Now, if this Q1 would not have been there, potential energy would have been zero. Right? So something is happening because of Q1. That is why there is a potential energy when you place Q1, Q2 over here. Right? So it makes sense to define a physical variable which is potential energy per unit charge. Are you getting it? More is the value of Q2, more is the potential energy.
Yes,
yes or no? Right? And it is directly proportional to Q2. So if I take 1 coulomb of charge, if potential energy is X, then if I take 2 coulomb of charge, potential energy will be 2X. Right? So it makes sense to define what is the potential energy per unit charge, whatever I keep here. So that if I multiply that with a charge, I'll get the potential energy directly. Okay? Now when it is a point charge, it is very simple. Direct formula of potential energy is there. But what if it is not a point charge, it is like a line of charge. The charge is distributed from here to here. Then there is no direct formula. So what I have to do? Then I have to find out what is the potential energy per charge for this entire rod over here and then multiply Q2 with it. Getting my point? Yes. So that is why there should be another variable defined which keeps track of what is the potential energy per unit charge. So just like electric field, which is force per unit charge, we are defining a physical quantity that is potential energy per unit charge, and that we call potential. Fine? So simply, potential is first of all represented by a letter capital V, which is potential energy divided by charge. Okay? Now if someone asks you the definition of potential, then this is the definition of potential. Find write down. Potential is the work done. Potential is the work done per unit charge, or potential energy is the work done. Potential energy is the work done to move one unit of charge, to move one unit of charge from infinity to the point where you're finding the potential. Potential is work done to move one unit of charge from infinity to the point where you are finding the potential. Okay? Written? One unit of charge from infinity to the point where you are finding the potential. Okay? Now, listen here. What I have written? Ask it to write. Work done to move the charge from infinity to that point. So whatever work you do, negative of that work will be done by the electrostatic field. Fine? And negative of that will be potential energy. Because in potential energy at infinity is zero. Fine? So it is one and the same thing. Potential energy per unit charge. I am repeating again. Whatever work you do, okay, negative of the work done should be by the electrostatic force, because total work done should be zero. There is no change in kinetic energy. You are slowly moving the charge from infinity to that point. Okay, so work done by you negative of work done by you is the work done by the electrostatic force. And negative of the work done by the electrostatic force is the change in potential energy. Change in potential energy is what? Potential energy now minus potential energy at infinity. Potential energy at infinity was zero. So net, everything boils down to potential energy. Fine. So mathematically straightforward, but if in your school they ask you the definition, you have to write like that. Otherwise, you will not get marks. Okay. Now, potential of a point charge, just like electric field of a point charge, is very simple. Which is what you know that potential energy between the two charges is K Q1 Q2 by R. So potential of a charge, let's say potential of a charge Q1 at a distance R is K Q1 by R. Understood? This is for the point charge only. Point charge. Okay? This is what? This is the potential of Q1 at a distance R. Right now. Got out. So if I tell you potential at a point is V1 and potential at the other point is V2. Okay? If I tell you potential at a point is V1 and potential at a point is V2 and you go from point 1 to point 2, how much potential energy is changed? V2 minus V1 is potential difference. Energy is how much? If charge is Q, potential at Q, V2 is Q times V2 and V1 is Q times V1. Right? So Q times V2 minus V1 is the change in potential energy. Fine? No doubt, right? Now there is a concept of equipotential surface. Equipotential surface is nothing but locus of all the points that has the same potential. Fine? Locus of all the points, write down locus of all the points that has same potential is equipotential surface. Locus of all the points having same potential is equipotential surface. So if you move along the equipotential surface, the work done will be zero. Yes or no? Change in potential energy is zero. V2 is equal to V1, so change in potential energy is zero. Okay? So work done was what? Work done was change in potential energy plus change in kinetic energy. Change in kinetic energy anyway, usually we can keep it zero. So if delta U is zero, work done will also be zero. Fine? So it makes sense to find out the equipotential surface for some basic charge distribution. Okay? For example, let's take a point charge, positive point charge. Write down. For a positive point charge, can you draw equipotential surface? Draw it.
Yeah,
it's a
sphere around the
surface. Is it sphere?
Yeah, at, around the point. Point at the center.
Sphere around.
For a point charge, it is concentric spheres. Now all concentric spheres are at a different potentials. Potential of this will be more or this will be more. Let's say this is V3, this is V2 and this is V1. Which potential is highest?
V1
is highest. Okay? So remember, when you move away from the positive charge, potential of the closest point will be highest. Okay? But this entire ring or entire sphere has the same potential. All of you are clear, right? Whatever is. Now it is very easy to draw the electric field lines due to a dipole or due to due to any particular shape and size of the charge. Okay, so if I somehow understand how potential or equipotential surface is placed with respect to electric field lines. So given electric field line, can I plot the equipotential surface? Then it will be easier for me. Okay, so basically I am trying to find out a relation between electric field and potential. Okay, write down a relation between E and B. There is a relation between force and the potential energy. Yes or no? What negative of the work done by the force is change in potential energy. But is there a relation between E and B? There has to be, because force is derived from E and potential is derived from V. Yes or no? So if I go from from point 1 to point 2 and delta V is the change in potential energy will be this. Any doubt? Q to delta V, right? Now can I find out change in potential energy in terms of electric field? Can I do that?
Yeah.
How? See, Q times E is what? Force. This is force, right? So work done will be what? Force dot product with delta R. Okay? So negative of work done should be equal to change in potential energy. They should be equal to minus of Q E dot delta R. Write this down. So Q delta V should be equal to minus of Q E dot delta R. Okay? This is a very, very important relation. Given electric field, you can find the potential. Okay? Now suppose the change is very, very small. If change is very small, I can write like this. dV is equal to minus of magnitude of E into magnitude of, let's say, dr into cos of angle between E and dr. Fine. Now tell me, what is E cos theta? Can I say E cos theta is component of electric field in the direction of dr?
Yes.
Because theta is angle between E and dr. Fine. So I can say that dv is equal to minus of electric field in the direction of R into dr. So from here you get E is equal to minus of dv by dr. Okay? Now here you need to understand that you are finding the component of field in the direction of R. Okay? So suppose V is a function of different variables. Suppose it is a function of X and Y both, then you have to partially differentiate it. Have you heard of partial differentiation?
Yes, sir.
Where?
Maths.
Maths, you already heard of partial differentiation. Right? So let's see whether you know it properly. Suppose V is given as 2X square plus 3Y cube. Can you find out electric field for this using this definition? Find out electric field for this potential field. Partial derivative with respect to R means you are assuming only R as a variable and all other variables you are treating constant. Fine. Understood all of you? No doubt? Nothing?
So when you partially differentiate?
This formula itself means that you have to partially differentiate. In the formula itself there is partial derivative. If you have to find out electric field, given what is potential, you have to differentiate partially. First you differentiate with respect to x, then with respect to y. Total electric field will be this I cap plus that j cap. Okay? Whichever respect you are differentiating, you will get electric field in that direction. If you are differentiating with respect to y, you get electric field in y direction. If you are differentiating with respect to x, you get electric field in x direction. Simple. Now tell me if dv is 0, what should be the condition for that? If electric field is not 0, cos theta should be 0. Cos theta can't be 90, no?
Cos theta is 0, degree should be
90. So theta should be 90.
Yeah.
Okay? So basically dr and electric field will be perpendicular to each other. Dr is what? Direction in which you are finding potential difference. Okay? So does it mean that equipotential surface should be perpendicular to electric field? I am saying dv is 0. Dv is in the direction of dr. And angle between dr and E is 90. So does it mean that if dv is 0, dr should be 90 degrees with E?
Yes.
Right? So write down equipotential surface will always perpendicular to the electric field. Is that the case here when you have drawn concentric circles?
Yes.
Right? Electric field was radial. Equipotential surface will be perpendicular to the field lines. Okay? It makes sense also. If you move in the direction of field line, work will be done. And negative of that work will be potential energy. And potential equivalent charge is potential difference. And I want to find out path where there is no potential difference. So work done should be 0. And if work done is 0, I should move perpendicular to the force. And if I am moving perpendicular to force, it has to be perpendicular to the field. Make sense? Right?